Thank you very much. Y'all need some coffee, evidently. It is so good to be here with you. We are so grateful to God for this glorious day in which to praise Him. There's nothing like coming to church on a beautiful Sunday, sunny morning. We are so glad you've made the sacrifice of your time to come and praise with us. Psalms 46 and 6, nations rage, kingdoms fall, but at the voice of God, the earth itself melts. The Lord all-powerful is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, see the fearsome things the Lord has done on earth. God brings wars to an end all over the world. He breaks the arrows, shatters the spears, and burns the shields. Our God says, calm down and learn that I am God. And learn that I am God. All nations on earth will honor me. The Lord all-powerful is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. I'm so glad in this weird and crazy political time, which I hate politics, I am so glad that God has said that He is our fortress. He will bring all wars to an end in His time and in His way. But in the meantime, we can trust that the God of Jacob is our fortress that we can run to. Be safe there. Calm down and calm all of our fears. I am grateful to a God that is the ender of wars. Let us go to Him in prayer today and let's worship Him for that peace and calm. Thank you, dear God, that you can bring a calm to our spirit in everything that is so tumultuous about us. You are the calm. You are the peace giver. Let us be peacemakers amongst ourselves, Jesus. We thank you and praise you for this day in which to praise the Lord God of Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and us, dear Lord. We are the continual generations that you have brought forth to praise you, Jesus. We thank you and give you glory today. In Jesus' name, amen.
How many of y'all believe it? He's able to do what He said He was going to do. Yeah! He's able! Yes! If you know the song, help us sing it. Oh, my God is
able. To do
just what He said.
Just what He said He would do.
Every
promise to you.
Don't Don't give up on God, 'cause He won't give up on you. He's able.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. I'm so thankful that God does not give up on us. Sometimes when we fall, God still doesn't give up on us. And I am so thankful for that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Our God is greater, isn't He? Greater than anything that we ever known. Hallelujah.
nothing who could ever stop us. If our God is for us, then who can stand again? If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? If our God is for us, then who can stand again?
Seek your face, oh Lord.
Make me a house.
So
but I'm never the same.
Make me a house of prayer.
House of prayer.
May the fire of my altar never burn out. Fire of my altar never burn out. Fire of my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer.
Fire
of
my altar.
Fire of my altar never burn out. Fire of my altar never burn out. Fire of my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer.
And we all say, Lord,
make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
I gotta seek your face. Seek your face.
Lord, make me a house.
Make me a house.
Make me a house of prayer.
A house of prayer.
A house of prayer.
May the fire on my altar never burn out.
Fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out.
Make me a house of prayer.
Fire on my altar.
Lord, we're in
a
change.
Fire on my altar.
Lord, we're gonna move on your
side. Fire on my altar.
Make me a house. Till I'm never the same, Lord.
Lift him in praise right now. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that you are the one that kindles these fires in our heart. You are the mighty warrior. You are the lion of the tribe of Judah. When you speak, the gates of hell tremble. When you shout, nothing can stand in your presence. You make the oceans roar. You can raise the valleys. You can lower the mountains. Father, you are an awesome God. And I'm so amazed, Father, that you love us, that you care about us, and you care about everything that we go through in this life. And this morning you were speaking to me, this morning you were saying things like, I'm calling unto the deep to come into the deep. I'm calling you out. We for so long have kind of gotten around the periphery of the thing. He's wanting us to wade in, wade into that deep place. And in that deep place, that warrior spirit will arise within you. That spirit of the Lord himself. And he is there to conquer with you. He is the conqueror. He'll pull down those walls, those towers that have been built to keep him out and to keep the enemy in. He'll remove those with a shout, with a trumpet blast. They are gone. He is the mighty King. Nothing can stand in his presence except his children. That's us. That's you and I. All those that he has called, all those that are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, we belong to him. I guess to put it lamer, he's the man. He's the man. You mess with me, you're going to have to deal with him. That's the spirit I feel today. God's wanting to deal with some things. We have some new folks that have never been here before. You know, at this time, we'll call the elders up. Delia, come on up. Come on up, Blade. Mike, come on up. If you have a need, Albert, come on up. If you have a need, Michael, come on up. Any need. Doesn't matter how serious the need is, the smallest of needs. He cares about everything. You got a situation in your life, that very first song they sang, God is able. God is able. You might ask, well, what's he able to do? Everything he said he can do. Everything. Nothing's left out. It doesn't matter who you are. It's the same for everybody. Everybody is able to receive from the Lord. It doesn't matter what you've ever done, ever. You may not even be in the right place right now. You're thinking in your own heart and mind. Jesus calls out and says, come just like you are. Come just like you are. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is, come. Let's continue. Let's praise a little bit. Those have a need, come on down. Pray for you.
Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
A house of prayer.
May the fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar, never burn out. Fire on my altar, never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. Fire on my altar, never burn out. Fire on my altar, never burn out. Fire on my altar, never burn out. Make me a house of prayer.
And we pray, Lord,
make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
Wanna seek your face, seek your face, oh Lord.
Lord, make me a house, make me a house of prayer, a house of prayer.
May the fire on my altar never burn out,
fire on my altar never burn out, fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer, Lord. Make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
I gotta seek your face. Seek your face, oh Lord.
Make me a house
until I'm changed.
Make me a house of prayer. A house of prayer.
May the fire on my altar never burn out.
Fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar never burn out.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
May the fire be a house of prayer.
May
the fire on my altar.
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 May the fire be a house of prayer.
May
the fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my
altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Make me a house of prayer.
Make me a house of prayer.
Day and night, night and day. Day and night, night and day. Day and night, night and day. Make me a house of prayer, everybody.
Day and night, night and day. Day and night, night and day. Day and night, night and day. Make me a house of prayer.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
I have to seek your face.
Day and night, night and day.
Make me a house of prayer.
Make me a house of prayer.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
I will not stop until I see your face.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
Make me a house of prayer. Say day and night, night and day.
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 I will not give up until I see your face.
Day and night, night and day.
Make me a house of prayer. Day and night, night and day.
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 Make me a house of prayer.
Make me a house of prayer.
Day and night, night.
May the fire on my altar,
fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out.
Make me a house.
Make me a house.
May the fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar never burn out.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Make me a house of prayer.
Make me a house of prayer.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Make me a house.
Make me a house of prayer.
Let it be the Lord.
Make me a house.
Make me a house.
Make me a house of prayer.
Lord, I gotta seek your face. Seek your face, oh Lord.
Make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
Make
me a house of prayer.
Oh, 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 oh.
Fire on my altar never burn.
Make me
fire on my altar never burn.
Let it not
burn
out.
Fire on my altar never burn.
Till all of me is gone.
Make me a house of prayer.
And it's all of you.
Fire on my altar.
I wanna be a different.
Fire on my altar.
I gotta make a change.
Fire on my altar.
Make me a house.
Make me a house.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my soul. I don't want to be the same.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
Fire on my altar.
I want to be different.
Fire on my altar.
Make me a house.
Make me a house.
Say day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
Oh.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
Day and night, night and day.
Make me a house.
Make me a house of
day and night, night and day.
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 your face. As we was praying up here today, and this isn't my normal kind of mentality, but the Lord really dealt with me today. If you're hiding things in your life that you know isn't right, the Lord says today He will expose it for your benefit. If you're hiding things you know that's wrong in your life that's going to affect you and others, the Lord says today He will expose it for your benefit. If you don't want that exposed today, you don't want it exposed in the future, you better come to a strong realization with Jesus Christ. And you better get in that altar, and you, not this altar, your altar. We call it the closet. You better crawl up in that closet and you better pour it all out and say, God, I'm not living this way anymore. I'm not hiding my stuff. You better find you an elder or someone you believe in, and you better go to them and say, this is what I'm struggling with. How many knows it's okay to struggle, but it's not okay to hide it? All right, come on somebody. Amen. How many would rather God just expose something for your own benefit? If I'm doing something, I want a prophet. I want a word from God. I want something just to hit me and say, hey, you can't do that no more. Anybody receive that? I know that's a strong word, but I'd rather be safe than sorry. How about you? Come on, somebody. You're dealing with stuff, and you're trying to deal with it on your own, and you ain't never going to deal with it on your own. You've got to learn just to lay it down at the altar and cast all of it on Him and say, God, I'm trusting you. God's going to empower people to overcome some addictions. There's people surfing the web, people looking at stuff you shouldn't be looking at. Come on, somebody. And you think it's funny and you think it's game. That thing's about to turn into an animal in your life. And when it gets through, you're going to have a broken home, a broken marriage, broken kids. Come on, somebody. The Lord is saying today, and there is a warrior spirit here today. There is a warrior spirit. Some of you is hiding stuff in your life and in your marriage, and you're thinking, if anybody knows, it's going to destroy me. You're hiding it. It's already destroying you. Your life is going down a wrong road, and you're thinking, if I hide it, I'm going to protect it. No. You know what you have to do? You have to confess it. Get it out. Speak it out. Get some help. Because one can put 1,000 to flight, but two can put 10,000 to flight. And a threefold cord is not easily broken. How many wants to become stronger? How do we become stronger? Come on, Joe, how do we become stronger? We come stronger together, brother. That's how we become. Alex, how do we become strong? Stronger together. I said, man, I don't want to be around some of this. You know what? There's people hiding junk, and then they wake up one day and their whole life is a mess. Hiding doesn't fix anything. Confession can fix everything. If you're dealing with thoughts that shouldn't be there, you better get to talking to somebody. If you're talking to somebody at work, come on somebody, you shouldn't be talking to in a way you shouldn't be talking to them, you better go home today and sit down with your spouse and say, honey, I got to make sure this is right. We got to come.
want us to be sensitive if there's an interpretation today. Lord, we're just sensitive. Isn't the Lord good this morning? You say, Pastor Mike, that makes me nervous. It makes me feel good. We got parents today that refuses to correct a child thinking they're helping it. Not realizing if they let that child rebel against them, he's going to rebel against the teachers. He's going to rebel against the Sunday school teachers. He's going to rebel against the church. Going to rebel against the authority. Going to rebel against the law, the pattern. God corrects those that he loves. Aren't you glad no names was mentioned today? You know why? Because he's a perfect gentleman. You can look over and say, must have been them. Amen. You can do whatever you want to do today with what God is doing. But this is what God's saying. Just get the junk out. Man, we live in a world where church people know more about Miley Cyrus and the Kardashians. And they think they're awesome because they know what's going on in the world or Hollywood. But I'm going to tell you, God wants to know what's going on the inside of us. Amen. Aren't you glad he's a healer of the broken heart today? Amen. God loves us. If you're dealing with something today, we're not asking for anybody to come forward. We're not come tell everybody your stuff. We could all come talk about our stuff, couldn't we? Find somebody you can trust. Lay it out on the altar. So many times when people finally come to church or to their friend, there's so much baggage. It's so hard to clean up. How many knows the quicker we deal with it, the easier it is to clean up? God is so good. Could you step across the aisle this morning? We got some guests here for the very first time. Introduce yourself. Amen. Tell him normally he loves everybody. Amen. Tell him normally he loves everybody. Amen. Shake somebody's hand. Ain't nobody moving. Everybody's scared to move. Saying, oh my God. What's somebody going to tell me? Don't confess it to me. Go tell Brother Smith. I don't need any more stuff on my hands here. Amen. Love on somebody. Hug somebody's neck. Amen. They need that today. Amen. God loves us. He'll chasten those that He loves. We'll correct those that He loves. Amen. After you do that, you can be seated. I know you've been standing a while. Amen. Kind of lingering here. And give the worship team a hand clap. Don't they always do such a great job? Thank you. Naisha, thank you. Even with her fill-in keyboard, her keyboard broke. But you can be seated today. Now you may feel like you've been to yoga class or the gym. Victor had a dream last night. He said, and they're new around church. And he said, I'm not a dreamer, but he said, last night I had a dream. I was in a dark tunnel. And he said, I started seeing the dead. He said, the dead was all around. He said, but then I looked down and there was a flashlight. And he said, I turned the flashlight on and I began to shine the light. He said, I don't know exactly what that means, but do we not know we're the light of the world? Do we not know that the scripture says you were dead in trespasses and sin? See, we don't die when we quit breathing. We're dead until we're born again. And Jesus said, if you believe on me, you will never die. Do you believe this? And I believe, Victor, what the Lord's saying today, there's people that are struggling with things, but God is going to use the church. You represent the church. I'm going to shine light. Amen. I'm thankful today we're the light of the world. We're the salt of the earth. Amen. And I'm telling you today, the light of Jesus, I don't care what tunnel. We always have that saying, I see the light at the end of the tunnel, and I hope it's not a oncoming train. How many's ever been in those situations in life? And you say today, Pastor Mike, I'm dealing with a lot of stuff. Man, this is kind of heavy this morning. No, this is good stuff. He's saying God's going to shine some light in our dark areas. And that's a beautiful thing, that Jesus came as the light of the world so that He could bring us out of darkness into this marvelous light. Amen, Victor. I believe God's going to be using you in a special way, you and your family. They've had some challenges. He's told me this week was one of the biggest challenges as he's ever had. You manage a trailer park that has 100 trailers in it, you're going to have some challenges. You got some crazy trailers and some crazy people in the trailers, all right? Amen, but let the light shine, Victor. Let the light shine. Don't you love the Lord today? Amen, God is good. We need to go ahead and take up our tithe and offering. I know we normally the preacher's on the floor by now, but go ahead, let's go get someone to help you there, brother. Brother Mike and Brother Daniel, that's good. Now this coming week, I need to make an announcement. Shanna may double this up so everybody gets it, but all right, could I have some of the elders? She's not feeling good. She was actually in the car. She didn't even feel like coming in, but let's just pray over her. Lay hands on her. This is Michael's daughter. Lord Jesus, come on, stretch your hands out towards her. Lord Jesus, so much sickness right now going around. But Lord, we declare life and healing and restoration. Lord, that immune system to kick in right now and the health of God to begin to move. Give her strength. God, touch her body. It's weak this morning. It's tired. Lord, right now, Lord, it's lethargic. But today, Lord, there's healing power and authority in your name. And Lord, we speak it today. You are the healer. And we release it right now in Jesus' name. We release it right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for faith. Thank you for faith. There's a lot of people dealing with sicknesses, aren't they? Amen. I mean, some of our praise team has been dealing with it. But let's just continue to pray. We got a special revival coming up this Friday at 7, Saturday at 6, and Shanna's going to hit it again during the announcements, Sunday at 10 with Chris Leach. Chris Leach has a unique ministry. You don't want to miss that. He has a ministry that's quite different than me and Dad or the elders of the church or even this church body. So if you're dealing with something, I want you to come out. This Wednesday night, we normally have coffee and connect, and we're going to change it up a little bit, okay? This is what we're going to do. This week, if you can, we're asking for you to do some fasting, if you can. Fasting is not just the absence of food, but it can also be fasting junk. And I'm going to tell you, sometimes the easiest way to get close to God is not eat something, is to turn some junk off. Turn some junk off. So this Wednesday night, we were thinking about just not having Wednesday night prayer and coffee and connect. We could let everybody kind of rest. But this Wednesday, there's no pressure. But if you feel like it and you want to, from 7 to 8 Wednesday night, we're just going to have prayer. No food. You ain't got to bring anything. If you want to, if you say, I don't want to pray an hour, show up at 7:30. Okay, we'll have the lights down at 8 o'clock. We'll have corporate prayer if you got a need. Can anybody help us with that, all right? If you say, Pastor Mike, if I come Wednesday, I got to miss Friday because I'm really a tired person. Just miss Wednesday and come Friday, okay? No one's going to pick on you, but we want to do some of that. How many will commit to some type of fasting this week for a revival of focus just to help us get focused? Well, thank you for that. And like I said, the lights will be dim. The music will be playing softly from 7 to 8 Wednesday night. I'll be here, and there's no pressure if you can, okay? Do you love the Lord? Are you thankful you're blessed? Are you glad you can give? Are you glad you got some food on the table? Place to go home to. All right. We're blessed in this nation. Let's pray over the tithe and offering. Jesus, we love you today. And Lord, we just pray your blessing, not our blessing, but your blessing that's already promised in your word upon the givers. Lord, you declare anything we give. It can be our words, our actions, our deeds, our finances, whatever we give, it's going to come back to us with a good measure. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will you cause men to give unto our bosom. So we declare today that our finances are blessed, that we sow good seed into good ground, and we thank you for the promises of your word upon our lives and families. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, I think I got confused there. What he told me to announce and what he decided is two totally different things. So we're going to have prayer Wednesday night from 7 to 8, kind of a come and go if you choose to, if you need to. We will have corporate prayer there at the end, but the lights will be down low when you get here and just kind of ease in and ease out as you so choose. Don't forget, you are going to be changing your clocks this Saturday night, Sunday morning officially, so don't forget to spring forward. We didn't realize we were going to be doing that when it was revival weekend, but that means you get to come to church earlier than you even had to wait for. You get to come to church almost an hour earlier. You're going to be so excited to get here, you're not even going to be able to stand it. We are excited about Brother Leach being here Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday morning. An awesome ministry that some of you from past years gone by, the old people, yes, I mean old, you will remember him. He does have an awesome ministry. He contacted us and has actually canceled another revival to be with us because his burden for this church was so great. So we expect some awesome things from God through his ministry. Believe with us. All right, children, let's get you going. 2 to 5 with Karen, 6 to 12 with the Riveras for Children's Church. 2 to 5, 6 to 12. Teens, you're going to be staying in. 2 to 5, and then 6 to 12. All right. They are so adorable. All right. Yay. All right, let's pray over these precious children. Father, we come before you amazed that you have given us the human lives that you have given us to raise, to train, to be an example. There is no greater calling in the kingdom of God than to raise children up in the fear and admonition of the Holy Spirit. Let our lives reflect that. Let them see the walk of God in our lives and know that there is mercy and grace abounding. And we thank you and praise you for the next hour or so that we can put the word of God into them, that the parents have already planted those seeds and we're just going to cultivate a little bit in the next hour or so. Water those seeds and let them grow firm roots in you. We thank you for this entrustment in Jesus' name. Amen. Beautiful, beautiful. We got to be with Corey and Amanda and all the family this weekend. And we were laughing because Corey is going to walk down the aisle in 50-some-odd days, and he is going to bawl and squall. That's just who he is. Rough, tumble cowboy, he's going to bawl, squall. And I got to almost crying there talking with them. But I'm like, God, what an awesome thing that you are good enough to give us children to raise. And then that we can turn them back over to you. And he's going to have an awesome life with Amanda. And y'all pray for them in the next few weeks. You know, if you've been through wedding time, you know the crunch that they can be feeling. But y'all help us pray that everything goes smoothly in the next few weeks for them. We are blessed to call Corey our son, and even more blessed to call Amanda our future daughter. We are so thankful. All right, Corey's preaching papa. He's the one that named him that, is coming to preach for you. Give him a hand as he comes.
Praise the Lord. All right, I need to get somebody to get those handouts I have back there. I need three or four guys to help me right quick. Let's get those out quickly because we're running out of time here. Praise the Lord. Good to be here today. Isn't that an awesome move of the Spirit we had today? Now, I'm going to do something different today. And I do need to pray for somebody. Why don't we just stretch our hands right now? That's Monica Acosta's mom. She's got a brain tumor, having surgery tomorrow, and we've been handed this request. Let's pray right now. In Jesus' name, Father, we ask right now to touch this lady. In Jesus' name, Lord, touch her, touch that tumor. We ask you to shrink it, God. Let the hand of God be upon her. In Jesus' name, be with her, Father, during this time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're thankful for that, but I'm going to do a little teaching today, and I was hoping to have that other 15 minutes that I don't have, so I'm going to have to really squeeze. So I'll be going about 150 miles an hour, so you better grab your bike. I'm glad somebody rode a bike today. We're going to be riding a motorbike. The cars are too slow. I want to show you, talk today about identifying the four beasts, and that's what they're handing out to you, the notes on this, and if I don't get through, you can just finish it at home yourself. This comes from a half of a teaching that I do called Identifying the Four Beasts and the Two Witnesses. And you say, well, why would you talk about something like this? Well, I want to show you who we are in Christ through biblical imagery. You wonder why in the world would God put all these things in the Bible about beasts and all this stuff and all these beings and all this stuff in Revelation that just scares you to death. You don't know what it means. Why would he put it in there? Why would he put it in there if he didn't want us to understand it? But it's a beautiful thing when you do begin to understand it. And when you see who we are in Christ, and it also shows you how God sees us through imagery and how powerful he sees us as. And it's kind of mind-boggling when you begin to see this. And this is actually, I do normally a bunch of teachings before I get to this. But I thought I would just share with you some of this to let you know and understand. If everybody got a sheet, everybody got your papers handed out? Don't have no help here. Who handed out papers? Because we got some that don't have papers. I printed out 50. Could maybe some share if some don't have any. Did anybody not get a paper? We got rent out up here. Maybe it's if a husband and wife could share, or a couple sitting right side by side could look on or something, whatever. I should have had 50. I thought that'd be enough if we share, if the husband and wife shares, or two people's daughter, maybe mother could share. We get these things going here. And They're going to be putting some of the scriptures up on the screen, and we're going to be talking about the book of Revelation today, as well as some other places, and a lot of people are afraid to venture there, but I do two teachings on the book of Revelation where I go almost verse by verse through the whole thing and show you what those images are and what they stand for, because there's a reason God put them there. And what I'm going to say today is probably different from what you've ever heard. How many have ever heard that the book of Revelation is what's going to happen to us at the end of the world? You ever heard that? Been taught that all your life? I was taught that all my life. You ever re-revelate, boy, this is what's going to happen to us. Well, I'm going to relieve your fears today. It has nothing to do with you at the end of the world. It has everything to do with you right now. So you'll feel good that you're a third of the world is not going to die in our future. A fourth of the world is not going to die in our future. That's all biblical imagery of incidents, and most of which have already been fulfilled. So, but a lot of people don't realize that. But if they would really read the book of Revelation without any outside influence, they wouldn't have any problem believing that. But we've been told this all of our lives, so we really are not careful to read it. But let's get into this right quick, because I'm totally going to be pressed for time today. But we started off by showing you the dealing with the setting and the time text of the book of Revelation is given by Jesus himself. Now, Revelation 1 and 1 says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Does it say it's the revelation of the end time? What does it say it is? The revelation of Jesus Christ. All right, the revelation which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things that must when? Shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified by his angel to his servant John. Now, the book of Revelation is about the unveiling of Jesus Christ and about the restoration of natural Israel, and not about the restoration of natural Israel. Dispensational theology has taught us, which came into being only 150 years ago, began to be started to be taught, and been extremely taught powerfully in the last 100 years. And it actually elevates natural Israel more than the church. And it's not about the restoration of natural Israel. It's actually a picture of the unveiling of Jesus Christ and his body, the church, and the setting up of his church kingdom, which is the New Jerusalem, his judgments on natural Israel for rejecting his kingdom. And that's a lot of what Revelation is about, the judgments of God on natural Israel for rejecting the gospel message that was preached to them by the apostles, and the destruction of natural Jerusalem and the old covenant worship system of animal sacrifices. Now, how many know that took place in 70 A.D.? In 70 A.D., there was a 3.5-year period of siege on Jerusalem that totally destroyed the city, the old worship system, and ended it all. Because you remember, Jesus constantly said these things would be fulfilled before his generation passed away, right? And so Jesus Christ was crucified around 30 A.D., and this happened in, was finished in 70 A.D. So that generation is about 40 years. So he had actually fulfilled that exactly. Now, dispensational teaching actually reverses these truths of Revelation and teaches the restoration of the curse, which is the law, and the removal of the blessing, which is Jesus Christ and his church. When you believe it, they try to get the church out of Revelation, say it doesn't exist there, and that's all for the future somewhere. But they make a terrible mistake when they do that, because you've just lost the meaning of Revelation, because it's the revelation of Jesus Christ and his church. And it's the judgments of God on those that don't obey the gospel. So here it is, and it's actually dealing with their time. Now, he didn't say it was going to happen 2,000 or 3,000 years in the future. He said it's going to shortly come to pass. All right, now let's read Revelation 1 and 3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of the prophecy, and keep these things that are written, for the time is at hand. Now, I believe the book of Revelation was received by John around 66 A.D., which was before the siege on Jerusalem ever started. And I know there's teachings about 90 A.D., and I can deal with that later. But there was only one man that said that about the 90 A.D. deal, and he actually had Jesus living till he was 50-something years old. And if you know anything about Jesus in his life, you know he was crucified 3.5 years after he began his ministry at age 30, which made him 33.5 years when he died. So he did not exist in 56, and neither was Revelation wrote in the 90s. But that's just a quick history lesson for you that's not ever studied that kind of stuff. Now, he said when the time is at hand, what does that mean? That means close by, not far off, something's going to soon take place. Revelation 1:7, behold, he cometh with clouds. Every eye shall see him, and also they which pierced him. All kindreds of the earth, which that word earth is also rendered land, shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Now, he's saying here he's coming with clouds. What is that? In biblical imagery in the Old Testament, actually the book of Revelation can be entirely interpreted from the Old Testament by using Old Testament imagery that was used in the Old Testament. Now, every time in the Old Testament when the Lord came with a cloud, he came in judgment. Now, he's done this many times already when the Bible said he was going to come in a cloud against Egypt. Well, what did he do? When you study the fulfillment of that, what he literally did was took another nation's army and came over and destroyed Egypt. He prophesied that many times in the Old Testament against several different nations. And so when his imagery doesn't change, he's saying here, I'm coming in clouds, means he's coming in judgment. How many of you ever heard of this thing, the great and dreadful day of the Lord? You'll read your scriptures carefully. It says it's a day of judgment. It's a day of what he's fixed to do. He's going to come and he's going to judge Israel for rejecting the new covenant message. But he's not going to judge the church. All right? He's going to allow the church to escape that judgment. How many remembers he said, not one hair on your head will be hurt? See, because it's not in the wrath of God. Because this is the true wrath of God that's going to be poured out. This is not something the devil does. This is something that God is actually going to do. This is dealing with his wrath. And his wrath is never poured out on his people. All right? So, when you see this here come with clouds, he just took the Roman army and brought them against Jerusalem just like he did other times and destroyed them. All right? And he goes, every eye shall see him. This is imagery dealing with the fact that all that's in Jerusalem is going to know that it has happened, including those who pierced him. Well, now, let me ask you a question. If those that pierced him is going to see this judgment, how is it going to be 2,000 years down the road and them still see it? I don't believe any of them people that was alive, you know, in 30 AD is still around today. If he is, I haven't met him, because they'd be over 2,000 years old. But if it happened in, say, 66 AD or 67 AD, this began, then it would have been a fact. Those people would still be living, wouldn't it? The ones that crucified him, one that pierced him. Now, who was that? The Bible tells you who it was. It was the Jews who killed the Lord Jesus. He said in the wrath of God, it says in the Bible, in the New Testament, is reserved up for them to the uttermost. So he's going to come with his wrath to the uttermost because they killed the Lord Jesus. And you'll find a lot about that in Matthew 23, but we don't have time to go and deal with all that. But so he's talking about the land here, and usually this is talking about the tribes of the land of Israel. So when it used the word earth, this really should have used the word land here, because it's the same Greek word. And in the King James interpreted it earth. And many times when the King James interprets Greek words, it changes the same word around and it messes people's minds up because they read it one way and they never associate that it's the exact same word. And it makes them interpret the word as something entirely different. So we'll get into all that. And I know I'm talking foreign to a lot of you right now and you're looking at me like, where the tree did this guy fall out of? But let's just keep reading because the scriptures will bear itself out. Let's look in Revelation chapter 22, the closing of the book of Revelation, to see what he says about the time text here. Revelation 22 and 6, he says, and these things are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show his servants the things that must shortly be done. Must what? You know, forsake today, can we turn the other lights on? Because we got people trying to read notes, and I see you straining to do it. This is just for today while we're trying to read these notes, okay? I can see you trying to, it's so dark you're having trouble seeing. If you're like me, I'm blind one eye and can't see out of the other. So I really have trouble getting it the right length, you know. I need a longer arm sometimes. But anyway, even the, so this is the closing. He said, this is things which must shortly be done. Now, folks, it doesn't say it's pushed way off. This is something that's going to happen thousands of years in the future. It's something that's going to happen right away, very quickly here. Even the closing, he said it again, things have got us. He said, behold, I come, verse 22 and 7, behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the saying of the prophecy of this book. Now, He said, you better keep what I'm saying because I'm coming really fast. After he gets this and you get this book, it's going to, these judgments that's being pronounced in this book, it's going to be coming at you. All right, so he saith unto me, seal not the saying. This is verse 22 and 10. This is powerful. Seal not the sayings of the prophet of this book, for the time is at hand. Now, God told Daniel, when Daniel got the same visions in Daniel that pertained to Revelation and had a part of Revelation, I teach a teaching called Daniel's 70th week, which confuses many people. And it actually brings it all to very clarity because Daniel got a vision of the future years up to a certain point. But in Daniel chapter 12, verses 4 through 9, can we get some of that up there? He said, but thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end, not end of time. People get this so messed up. There's a difference between the time of the end and the end of time. Because here's what God's dealing with. The time of the end is going to be the end of the old Jewish covenant of law keeping and going to be the beginning of the new covenant age of grace and Jesus Christ. All right? He said, even to the time of the end, many shall run to and fro and knowledge will be increased. Let's get to the next verse. Let's see if I want to read it. No, let's go to it. Just tell me, I saw two men on the banks of the river, two angels were there. Let's go, we don't have time. And he said to the one clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall it be to the end of these wonders? Now, next verse. And the man that clothed in linen looked at him and he said, it's going to be for a time and times and a half. He was accomplished to scatter the holy people. What's happened? When this thing happens, this 3.5 year period, time is one, times is two, half time, other times, it even gives you the exact number of days, 1,260. All right? And he says, when this 3.5 year period comes, it's going to scatter the people. Now, you know, the Jews were conquered and scattered all over the world, took captive into all nations to fulfill this in 70 AD. It happened. So it's going to be just like he says here. He said, but it's going to be for a time of time. He said, the holy people's got to be scattered. Now, let's go and read a little further here. He said, but I didn't understand what it was. He said, what's going to be the end of these things? Go ahead, next verse. And he said, go away, Daniel. It's closed up and sealed till the time of the end. Now, next verse. Many shall be purified, made white, tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. All right. So here we got it here. He said, because this stuff's got to be sealed up for now. It's going to be a 3.5 year period, but we'll seal it right there. Now what happens? We're given the book of Revelation. All of a sudden, you're going to see where they open this book. John's going to open these books. And you'll see Jesus in chapter 5 of Revelation 5. He actually has the power to unloose the seals and begins to reveal the judgments of God that's going to fall on Jerusalem. So he is going to unseal this 3.5 year period of time. And so we have Daniel couldn't tell you about it, but John is going to definitely tell us about it. And he's going to unseal it. So why? Because this is the time of the end. This is the end of the old covenant system of law. How many of you have heard where there's going to be the stars are going to fall from the sky and all this stuff, you know? You see all that in the Bible? If you really get into that, I'm going to tell you exactly what that means. That has happened several times in the Old Testament already. And every time that happened, it was the fulfillment of it was a change of government. And that's why he lists that in the book of Revelation, in the book of Matthew, and other places, because we said the sun, the moon, the stars are going to fall. What's happening? The old covenant system of government is going to fall. And the new covenant system of grace and Jesus Christ, aren't you glad we're under grace through the law? Because under law, you wouldn't have got a chance to go home and make things right. We'd have dealt with it today. Boom, you know. I'm glad we're under grace. I need the grace of Jesus Christ. So, but anyway, let's move on here. I don't have time to get into all that. So he says it's the end of time. I mean, not the time of the end, not the end of time. And 22 and 12 says, I come quickly, my reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be. What is he talking about there? The ones that obeyed the new covenant system, it's going to be rewarded. The ones that accepted Jesus, that accepted grace, they're going to be saved. Because remember, Jesus said, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, he warned them. He said, don't stay here. get out of the city. Guess what? Well, the Roman army surrounded Jerusalem. All of a sudden, for some strange reason, they fell back. And the followers of Jesus, remembering his words, fled the city. And once the Christians were all out of Jerusalem, and only the unbelieving Jews that didn't believe the new covenant was left there, the Romans came back and totally devoured the city. Wiped it out. Jesus said there won't be one stone left upon another. And he brought judgment against Jerusalem, totally destroyed the old worship system. And this was the sign to the Jews and to the Christians that Jesus Christ is now ruling in the heavens. That's the sign right there. This is the coming in the clouds of judgment. He judged Jerusalem, destroyed it, and now Jesus is ruling in the heavens. And he rewarded the wicked with the judgment, and he rewarded the... You know what this kind of sounds like? It kind of sounds like the... if you ever read the Song of Moses in Deuteronomy 32, 40 through 4 through 43, what the Song of Moses is not a beautiful song. It's a song of judgment against Jerusalem. In a particular generation where they're going to be allowed given a covenant, and they're going to reject that covenant, and judgment's going to fall in that generation. So even Moses sung a song about this time. You're going to find that probably half your Bible is dealing with a time. It's called the time of the end, when there's going to be a transfer of covenants, and they're going to transfer from law to grace, and there's going to be a tremendous judgment against Jerusalem, because they killed the Lord Jesus, the Bible said, and their own prophets. And Jesus said, you're going to kill the ones I send. Who is that? The apostles. He said, and because of this, he said, judgment's going to come to your house. And I'm going to destroy this city, and there won't be one stone left upon another. And your house is going to be left desolate. What? The old natural Jewish house of law and law giving. And Paul even said, they're still there making those sacrifices of animals that can never take away sin any longer. Because Jesus died once, he said, to take away our sins forever. So he totally ended that thing. I get a drink of water because my mouth's getting dry. All right, so when you're going to reward the wicked. Now, this is kind of like also the parable of the wheat and the tares. Now, in the parable of the wheat and the tares, how many of y'all have been taught that the righteous are going to be caught away? Well, that's not what the parable of the wheat and tares says. The parable of the wheat and tares says he's going to come and take the tares first. Who is the tares? That's the wicked. The Bible takes it clear. That's the seed of the devil. That's the devil's seed. He said Satan sowed those seed. I'm going to get to, because if I take the wheat, you know, I mean, I'm just going to, you know, I'm going to rip things apart here. I'm going to take the tares out. Then I'm going to let the wheat shine forth as the sun. What did God do? He took away the wicked and left the church to shine forth as the sun of righteousness. Because who is the light of the world? We're the light of the world. He was proven to all nations, this is the time of the end. A new covenant is being instituted here. And the old covenant system is being took out, and a new covenant system is beginning. It's called the kingdom of God. Aren't you glad we're in the kingdom today? 2,000 years later, it's still working. We're still preaching the same message. We still have the same methods. Now, and also, when I've taught on this, and about the 144,000 in the New Jerusalem, these are nothing more than symbolic pictures of the church. That's all they are. 144,000. 12 is the number of perfection for the church. 1,000 is always a number of perfection. So you get 12 times 1,000, you got 12,000. You get 12 times 12,000, you get 144,000. So what have you got? You got multiples of perfection times perfection in numbers. It's not a literal number. I know some believe that there's going to be 144,000 at the end. There's going to be powerful witnesses for Jesus. But this is actually a symbolic number that represents the entire church of the living God. You see how Jesus sees us, the number he sees us as being perfected by his blood, perfected by his spirit. And they're the ones that's going to preach the gospel, and they did. Actually, it's a representative of the early church preaching the gospel to them. Now, and then Revelation 4:1 said, and I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven, and the first voice I heard said, come up hither. And I will show you things that are going to be hereafter. Hereafter what? Here for the time that I'm talking right now. But he did say, remember, it's going to shortly happen, but it's going to follow you. Now, dispensational theology teaches you that right here, the church was took out. This was the rapture. Doesn't say anything about it being a rapture there. What happened? He was caught up into the Spirit. Just like Paul was caught up into the Spirit. Just like prophets throughout the Word of God was caught up into the Spirit. Let me tell you, you get a revelation from God, you're going to have to get caught up in the Spirit to do it. I've been caught up in the Spirit, and you can definitely tell I hadn't been raptured yet. God carried me down one time in a vision and showed me what a lost, carried me down and symbolized hell to me and showed me what a lost person is going to actually feel like on the day of judgment. Then he took me up out of that and took me up over the earth till I saw that he was holding me, he was at my back holding me in his arm, and I saw the earth and fires begin to come up all over the world, little fires. And I said, Lord, what is this? He said, this is these are people that's going to come to God someday through something that's going to happen in your ministry. Well, that was fulfilled through rightly dividing the word. This Bible study that I came out with, and I've got hundreds and literally thousands of stuff in there in big boxes where we've saved through my teaching on tapes in Africa. Whole villages have been saved on houseboats. Riding down the river, they played my rightly dividing the word ministry tapes one time. And while they were floating down there, they heard the truth and all of a sudden began to baptize people in Jesus' name over the side of the boat. I got letters of testimony about that. So this is something, and when I met Tudor Bismarck, Apostle Tudor Bismarck, about to hold a prayer conference up in Illinois, he said, rightly divine the word, man, that's empowered my life. He said, I've taught that all over Africa. So God knew when God gives you a vision, it will come to pass. See, when God tells you something, it's going to happen. So I've been caught up in the Spirit. I've had the Lord speak to me. I got a lot of what I'm teaching you today through the revelation of the Spirit. But it's not being raptured out of the earth. And he was just, look at verse 4 and 2. Immediately I was in the Spirit. Behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that was to look like a jasper and a sardine stone. Anytime you got a stone, that usually represents Christ. And there was a rainbow round about the throne. Now, this is all powerful symbolic figures, is what they are. The different colors of the rainbow. It images God in power, symbolizes him power of sitting on the throne. It's a sight like an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and their head on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. There were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. Now this is what, when you read all this, you think, wow, this is awesome, powerful, crazy. What is this stuff, man? I'd like to be there. Oh, you're going to be shocked in a minute because I'm going to show you. You have been. You just never realize what he's talking about. Now, Revelation 1:20 reveals who these are. Revelation 1:20, the mystery of the 7 stars that thou sawest in my right hand and the 7 golden candlesticks. Now, this is actually candle stand. I mean, remember the picture of the menorah where the oil flows through and you got 7 lamps burning. And it's actually got oil flowing through the stands and you got a wick in the top. This is actually what it was. The King James rendered it candlesticks, and I don't want you to picture a candle sitting here. This is actually candle stands, got oil. How many knows oil represents the Spirit of God? And vessels. How many know we are a vessel that the oil flows through? We are a vessel that the Spirit flows through to give light, because we are the what? Light of the world, it's done been said here today. So this is imagery, representing something. And so he said, it goes on to say, the 7 stars are the angels or the messengers of the 7 churches, and the candles, 7 candlesticks which thou sawest are the 7 churches. He said, those are the church. Just what I just showed you. That's the picture of the church. So the lampstands he saw there was actually the church. All right, so that's us. That was them then. Actually, this is pertaining to their time, but how many know it goes right on to our time? So we're still part of the church. The seven lamps and the seven spirits are a picture of the church. So it makes, if you make one verse over there a rapture, then the church is done gone. How could it still be the church? You see what I'm saying? They'll tell you there's nothing mentioned about the church in Revelation. Church is all in Revelation. It's all about the church. All right, now, some believe that Isaiah 11 and 2 is a list of these spirits. I have no problem with that. So let's just read Isaiah 11 and 2. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, and the spirit of wisdom, understanding, spirit of might, spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. So you do have spirits of God. He said this is a seven spirits of God. Revelation 4 and 6. And before the throne was a sea of glass like unto crystal. We'll cover that sea of glass in another teaching. I don't have time to get to it today. But some of you have experienced the sea of glass. And if someone is sick today, they'd be experiencing today. Could I prove to you what that is? And in the midst of the throne, but now careful, in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes, before and behind, had eyes all over them. There's four beasts. Now, notice where they are. You got 24 elders that's around the throne. 24 seats around the throne. Then you got these four beasts that's got eyes everywhere. They're standing right in the middle of the throne. They're right in the middle of everything. All right? And he said, notice the four beasts in the midst, that's important, because the four beasts is a picture of the apostolic ministry. While the 24 elders, and I'm going to prove this to you, is a picture of the church, Jew and Gentile, in one body of Christ. See, there's 12. This has got to be pictured. 12 Gentiles, 12 Jews. When I teach you on someday on the two witnesses, you'll understand why this imagery is. When you read the book of Romans, it'll tell you. You need the imagery because there's both Jew and Gentile. Jesus said, I come to break down the middle wall of partition between Jew and Gentile and make both Jew and Gentile one new man in Christ Jesus. So it don't matter anymore if you're male or female, bond or free, whatever you are. See, if you're baptized into Christ, you're Abraham's children. See, we're one body now. There's no more Jew and Gentile. No more Jews are better than Gentile. Gentiles are better than Jews. We're just one book of Christ. It's everyone who hears his word who obeys the covenant. It don't matter what we are. All right, but there's these four beasts. Now, these eyes, what are these eyes? These are the eyes of your understanding that's revealed in Ephesians 1, 17 and 18. Now, read that right quick. Show you what it is, what God's picturing here. He said that the God of our, this is Ephesians 1, 17 and 18, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened that you may know what is the hope of his calling, the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints. Now, what is he showing you? He's showing you the ministry has eyes all over them. They have the revelation of God in them. They are in the midst of the throne. Okay? So they have been given understanding by God. And so this is what this is a picture of, the picture of the ministry of God. And it's going to do. And he said the first beast was like a lion. Second, this verse of Revelation 4 and 7. The first beast was like a lion, second like a calf, the third beast like a man, and the other like a flying eagle. What is this imagery? Now, here, let me tell you about this imagery. These are the four standards or instances of the four divisions of the tribes of Israel. That's one imagery, interpretation this could be. Because God, see, I believe that the true Israel of God now is the church, Jew and Gentile in one body of Christ. All right? Now, some believe that these different faces of pictures of the various attributes of the ministry. An example, lion is power, calf is sacrifice, man, humanity, eagle, the spirit-led God part of it. And we've had many times pictures of eagles in visions and dreams to show us about being spirit-led and powerful, okay? So, but here's the main thing. Whichever one of them you want to believe is fine, or they may both be right. But Revelation 4 and 8, and the four beasts, each had six wings. This is important, six. Six wings about him. They were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, which is and which is to come. Why, six is the number of man. And God is showing you in this part right here with the six wings, in this vision, He's either going to tell you they're men or He's going to show it by imagery that they're men. This represents man. He's showing you that these four beasts are actually men. Okay? And so 4:9, and when the beasts give glory and honor and thanks to Him that sit on the throne, who liveth forever and ever. Verse 10, 4 and 10, the 24 elders fall down before Him that sit on the throne and worship Him that liveth forever and forever, and there cast their crowns before the throne. And saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, receive honor, for Thou hast created all things, and Thy pleasure were they created. Now, notice here's the key you got to catch. The 24 elders do what the beast do. They follow the beast. Now, what is showing? The church is going to follow the ministry. Whatever the ministry teaches, that's what the church is going to be. You will never go to a level. I'm going to say never. I don't think you will. It may be possible, but it's not probable for you to go to a level above the ministries in your church. You're going to have to, the ministry has to lead you to these levels. When the ministry cast their crowns, then the 24 elders cast their crown. They were imitating what the four beasts did. So this is the picture of the church following the Spirit-led ministry who has revelation, eyes everywhere, revelation from God, and they're doing the will of God, and they're following God, and the church is following all of this. See, the ministry through the revelation of the Spirit can take the church to a whole new level in God. If your church ministry doesn't have any revelation, you're not going to get much revelation and much understanding. If the church ministry don't believe in prayer, you won't believe in prayer. If they don't pressure you to get close to God, you won't get close to God, probably. Now, some people do have that, but you're just not going to rise much above what's taught in the church. Now, you go to all churches all over town, you'll find that to be true. Whatever they're taught at the pulpit, that's what the church generally is. Now, in Revelation 5:1, He said, I saw the right hand of Him that sit on the throne, a book written on backside, sealed with seals. I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who are worthy to open the book and to loose the seals. Who can open this book and loose the seals? No man in heaven or earth nor under the earth was able to open that book. Who can loose these seals? Who can loose these judgments? Now, these are actually going to be judgments. So how do I know this? Because I've studied the book of Leviticus. And Revelation is actually a fulfillment of chapter of Leviticus chapter 26 that says that someday there's going to be four sevenfold judgments that's going to come against Jerusalem. And that's what you have in the book of Revelation. It's four sevenfold judgment, one being a lesser judgment. You know, a one-third, starts out, I believe, a one-quarter, you know, a one-third. Then it's a greater judgment. Then the fourth set, which is the vows of the total destruction of the city, and it says Babylon the Great is fallen. It's gone. It's destroyed completely. And each one, He said, if you don't repent, I'm bringing more judgments against you. So He's giving Jerusalem a set of judgment. He said, who can open these seals and to open these things? Who can do it? And so they're looking for somebody that's worthy, but nobody on the earth is ready. But look at verse 5. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David. How many knows that's Jesus? That died on Calvary without sin, had the right, because He lived here for 30 years, actually 33 and a half years, without sin. He was killed innocently for our sin, and He was worthy now as the resurrected Christ to open these seals. He prevailed to open the book and to loose the seals thereof, because He is the only one worthy to open that book. And there's some other things here, but I don't have time to cover it. Revelation 5:6 says, behold, I lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb. Now, Jesus Christ was not only in the midst of the ministry. How many knows Jesus Christ is in the midst of the church? How many knows you have the same Spirit of God that I have? You came to God the same way I did. So we're not saying that ministry is elevated over the church. There just should be, ministry should receive revelation of God. They should be in a closer place with God. That's why you folks pay tithes. So we can have time to spend time before the Lord while you're out working. Does this make any sense? Because the Lord said the tithes is your inheritance. And he said, this is what it is. It's your inheritance. And so you gotta give us time to go pray for people in hospitals. I had to go up one day this week when Brother Mike was out of town. I had to go up and pray for two people in Houston. You know, if I'm not full time, I can't do that. So it gives us time. So it's just, we got the same God, but the Lamb is right there, and he's right in the midst of all this. Now, what is this? He said, in the midst of the throne, the four beasts, he said, verse 5 and 6, Revelation 5 and 6, behold, in the midst of the throne and the four beasts, in the midst of the elders, stood a Lamb having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into the earth. Seven is God's number of perfection. All right? What he's saying, he's got seven eyes, total understanding, and he said he's got seven horns. What is horns? Horns in the book of Daniel symbolized kingship, rulership, authority. If you read the book of Daniel, every time that a new king was uprooted, he had so many horns or whatever. Then this other horn uprooted him, and he came into power, because horns represent kingship and authority. How many knows that? So you're getting a picture here of a Lamb that has all knowledge and all authority, that's in the midst of the four beasts and in the midst of the church. Now, that ought to make you feel pretty powerful. See, God don't see you. This is how God sees you. God don't see you as some little anemic church that can't blow the dust off of a peanut. He sees you as somebody that he is inside of. How many ever heard the scripture? Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. When I have combated, I'm not getting into this too much, but I've combated demon-possessed people, and I have in my ministry. He wasn't afraid of me, but he was afraid of what was in me. And by the power of God in me, I was able to bind those demons and cast them out of people. And they're still living for God today. And some of them are my best friends on Facebook. But at one time, they were demon possessed. Why? Because I have Jesus in me. You think the devil's scared of me? Oh, no, he's not scared of me. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Didn't Jesus not say, I'm giving you power over all the powers? He said, I'm giving you power to walk on demons and serpents. I'm giving you power over them. And what he symbolizes here, I'm giving you power over them. Did the apostles cast out demons in people? Yes, they did. Did they pray for people and people get healed and stuff? Yes, they did. See, God sees us. He sees us. We are the vessel. But inside of us is the oil. We are the light. But in us is a Lamb that has seven eyes and seven horns. Honey, you don't have nothing that he don't know. And sometimes he'll let me know some of this. You know, you sit down with people sometime, all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost breaks out. You sit down with somebody, and all of a sudden, God began to show him everything about these people. Why? Because that guy showing you that stuff, he's got seven eyes and seven horns. He not only has the eyes to understand what they're going through, he's got the power to stop it. Right. If they would yield to him. So he sees us in imagery as something very powerful, very authoritative, because of him being in us. So this is all this is. He's showing us here that God is in the church and God is in the ministry. And he's got perfect power and perfect understanding. And so here's a picture of Jesus Christ, who had perfect understanding, perfect power. Now, he's in the ministry, he's in the saints, and what's he doing? He sent them into the world with the gospel. So he took the book out of the right hand and he opened the seals. And the four, now look at verse Revelation 5 and 8. When he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps, golden vials full of odors, which are the what? Prayers of the saints. And we've talked about that here in this church. That's the prayer. That's what they're saying about the prayers of the saints today. They got golden vials. The odor was coming out of these golden vials. He gave, what is that? That's the prayer. He's telling you what it is. See, imagery is a true, actually event that's represented by some type of imagery. So what the true event is, this is the saints praying. But the imagery is they have this vial here that's got these odors coming up to God as a sweet-smelling savor. He said, now that's when the saints are praying. This is what you do to God. This is how you affect Him. When we get on our knees and begin to pray, we really affect God. Matter of fact, it was their prayers that brought down Jerusalem. I could prove that to you, but I don't think I'll get that far today. But and the Bible said that they fell down before the Lamb, and that prayer, he said, and said verse 5 and 9, and they sung a new song. What's this new song? Thou art worthy to take the book and open the seals thereof. Thou hast now listen, this is the four beasts and the 24 elders. Watch what they sing. Thou hast redeemed us to God. If this was some big old beast, he couldn't be redeemed to God. If this was an angel, it couldn't be redeemed to God. This is the four beasts and the 24 elders. God is showing you here, this is people. This represents people. The ministry and the church begin to sing, Thou hast redeemed us to God. Wow. See, out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. What do you mean every tongue, kindred, people, and nation? Reverend Nate, what's your nationality? Hispanic? What's your nationality? Would you say black? Guess what? I'm white. What are we all doing here together? He said, I'm bringing them out of everything. If we was a little more mixed today in Houston, we'd probably have some Chinese, some Japanese, some every other kind of knees, because it don't matter as long as they get on their knees somewhere and call to Jesus Christ and say, help me, oh God. He said, it's only by your blood, it's only by your power, no matter what nation we come out of. Let me tell you a little secret today. Jesus Christ destroyed racism at Calvary. Even though CNN and Fox and these news stations and some of our presidents and other people are trying to raise up division again and racial division, if you don't catch that, you ain't catching good. Because I hate it when they do that stuff. Because it's just creating bitterness and hatred against people that Jesus Christ destroyed and broke down, because His people come out of all nations and we can't have hatred. If you got hatred against anybody, there's something missing in your spirit. Because Jesus said you got to have love. Jesus is the spirit of love. And He's showing us here, these people are coming out of all nations and countries and people. That's why we got a mixed church here. Because they come from everywhere. Whosoever will, no matter if it's male, female, slave, or free, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. Amen. Now, these people were redeemed. That means they were people, wasn't it? That was the early church that got saved. And they're going out to do a work for God. See, this is positive proof these are little people. And look, verse 5 and 10. And has made us unto our God, what? Kings. And what? Priest. What's a king? He has authority. What's a priest? He has understanding. He has eyes. One has eyes, the other has horns. We are kings and priests unto our God. We're going forth with authority, and we're going forth with understanding to preach the gospel into all nations. That's why He's called the King of Kings. Well, who are the kings He's king over? You and me. He's the Lord of lords. Who are the lords that He's Lord over? Us, the church. We are in His kingdom. Does this make any sense to you? We're not in a church, we're in a kingdom. He's our Lord. Now, you can be in a church and not be in the kingdom. I'll let you pray about that one a while until you get to understanding. Praise God. Now, this is a picture of the eye and the horn ministry, which is understanding and power, priesthood and kingship, apostles and prophets, going forth to reach our nation for Jesus Christ. They're going forth to do things for the Lord. And I'm not even going to get halfway through with this one. I'm going real slow because we got so many new people here. I'm not even going to get started with this thing. I'm only halfway, not even halfway through right now. In verse 5 and 11, behold, I heard a voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast and the elders. The number of them were 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. This Greek word here is myrios, which Strong's Concordance says is a myriad or an indefinite number. See, thousands is not, how many heard me tell you that thousands is not a definite number? All right? This is Strong's Concordance telling you that the Greek word here means an indefinite number. Well, it's just a few folks here worshiping. No, it's thousands of them worshiping. How many know 3,000 got saved? Around 3,000 got saved on the day of Pentecost. There's thousands in the church. And so you got to realize here that I'm glad it's not just a few. And so Revelation 5:11, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. This is what they're doing. Now you're going to find these four beasts are mentioned throughout the book of Revelation and various seals and judgments. You'll find that these judgments actually were handed to God by beasts sometimes. This means that not only did the saints of God whose prayers were in that vow, because see, the Jews of that day and the law was what was killing the early church. You got to understand this. And they were praying for God to give them relief from having their children killed and the church killed. How many knows all the apostles got killed except John? See, Peter was crucified upside down. There was a merciless slaying of things going on here. And they were praying for deliverance from this. And God was going to bring judgment against them as a result of this someday. And so you'll find them throughout there in Revelation. Now, you'll find them, you know, remember, how many of you remember Mark 11 where Jesus cursed the fig tree? And a lot of people say, well, fig tree represents Israel. Well, if it does, Jesus cursed it because it didn't have no fruit on it. And maybe if you study the scriptures carefully, he said, you're going to have to bring forth fruit. He said, you got power to say to that, be thou removed and cast into the sea. And in the book of Revelation, we find that actually happening. And he said, speak to that mountain, and it'll be removed and cast into the sea. Look at Revelation 8 and 8, when the seals are loosed, and the second angel sounded where a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. See, this is the judgment. This is the one-third judgment. This is when Issus happened. So this is the second set of judgments. But it actually was a time when, if you'll read, you'll see it find again in there, mentioned in the prayers of the saints. And they were praying for God to help them. That's just like when we get face cancer, we pray for God to help us. If we were facing a time today that when we walked out that door, we might be killed by somebody. China has faced this. Russia has faced this. And yet people want to go back under socialism? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, baby, ain't nothing free. That free corn we give them deer, it ain't because we like to eat them. That free corn we give them deer, one of these days they're going to walk out there to get that free corn. Guess what? I'm going to be standing there with my 30-06. They give you all this free enticements to suck you in to governmental control rather than God's control. I don't want to be controlled just by the government. I want to be controlled by God and His government. You understand? Well, I won't get into that. I promise I'll stay out of politics. But anyway, so be careful what you want for free, because I'm telling you right now, nothing's free. We're thankful for what things we have. It just wants to flow along with the system because we ain't got much choice. But you know, whatever or whoever is in office. So, but I'm just telling you, you know, that's what happened. They were in such a thing that they were being killed by the government of that day. in this day and hour, that which was being enticed by the Jews. That's the picture you see in Revelation. Where, I mean, saw in Revelation, there was a beast that had seven heads and ten horns, which is ten rulerships. And I can show you what that is, and I do in my writings and my teachings. But this harlot was sitting on them. Well, that harlot is Jerusalem. And she was riding the Roman Empire, which is a city that sits on seven hills. She was riding that empire to kill the apostles, kill the early church. They would, I mean, those, the Jews didn't kill Jesus, but they accused Jesus and let the Romans do it. They made the Romans do it. We don't want Barabbas, we want Jesus to die. You see what I'm saying? But God didn't say the Jews, the Romans did it. God said that in the book of New Testament, the Jews who both killed the Lord Jesus and his own prophets and are now persecuting us, Paul said. See, they caught on to that quick. But the government of that day was after them. And they were being pushed by the belief they wanted to hold on to law. See, they didn't want Christ to come in. They didn't want liberty. They wanted to hold on to law. And so anyway, in Revelation 7:17, the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, shall lead them into living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. See, this is showing you relief because of Jesus Christ. You see judgment, then you see relief. Now, look at Revelation 6:9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God, for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? See, our blood. And white robes were given to every one of them, because they were killed by that group. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little while until their fellow servants also and their brethren should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. So what happened? The people were being killed by this, and they were praying for relief from it. In Revelation 8:3 says, And another angel came and stood on the altar, a golden censer there was given to him, much incense, this is much power for prayer, that they should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. See, they're praying for relief. And the smoke of the incense which came up, the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hands. And the angel took a censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and cast it to the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquakes. Now, while we're there, let me just stop a minute and show you something, because I'm going to run out of time anyway. Voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquakes. What is that? You'll find it at the end of each of the seven judgments. There was seven, seals first. Then someplace in there, there's, seven thunders, I believe. And there's another one. I can't even think what it is right now. But there's another seven. Then there's the seven vials, the final seven vials of God's wrath being poured out. At the seventh one of each of them, because remember Leviticus 26 said I'm going to send four sets of sevenfold judgments on Jerusalem for the rejection of my covenant. All right? So when each one of the seven says there's lightnings and thunderings and earthquake and great hail, what is that? That's a symbol of judgments according to law. Because when Moses went up into the mountain and got the law, what happened? There was voices and thunderings and earthquakes. So this is showing you that this judgment that is going to be poured out, because how many knows the New Testament says if you don't come into the New Covenant, you're going to be judged under the old according to law. And under the law, no flesh will ever be justified. No flesh has ever been saved. You just push your sins back with your faithfulness till Jesus could come. Hello. So he's showing you here they didn't accept their grace that Jesus offered, so he's judging them with law. And that's what he's showing there. There's voices and thunderings and earthquakes because that law that Moses got in the mountain is going to judge them. All right? And I'm just trying to look for a convenient place to quit. I'm halfway. I want to finish the other half. We can be through by one. I'm just kidding. I'm not going to do that to you. Because I haven't even got to Ezekiel, because Ezekiel's got this same thing in it. I didn't even get to use my little thing or nothing. Oh, I'm so sorry. But anyway, this is showing judgment. And the seven angels, Revelation 8:6, seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Now the seven trumpets are going to sound. Of course, and we get realized then that Revelation chapter 5 showed us this picture of the Lamb with seven eyes, seven heads, standing in the midst of the four beasts, the 24 elders. It showed them singing a song of redeemed out of every tongue and kindred and nation. And this is what all is going here. Now look at, when you get to the 144,000 in Revelation 14, you see the exact same picture you just saw using different imagery. Well, who's that 144,000? It's the same church going forth to preach the gospel. Look at Revelation 14:1. And I looked, and behold, a lamb stood on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 whose father's names are in the forehead. How do you get the name in the forehead? The Bible says in Revelation, nobody knows has that name except him that's received it. How do we get it? When you're baptized into Christ, you're put on Christ. See, that's why this is so important. And you believe in Jesus. You got your Father's name. Jesus said, I come in my Father's name. I'm going to send the Holy Ghost in my name. You won't find another name in here other than Jesus. It's the only name given among men whereby we must be saved. And I heard a voice from heaven. It's the voice of many waters and the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers rejoicing. And they sung a new song before the throne, before the four beasts and the elders. No man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are redeemed people from the earth. All right? He said, these are they which are not defiled with women. They're virgins. What's that symbol of being made righteous? How many know there's the parable of the virgins in the Bible? The five foolish and the five wise. And the five foolish lost their all, which is the Holy Ghost, right? See, when you get the Holy Ghost, you get baptized in Jesus' name, you are marked with the mark of God. You are sealed with the seal of God. That thing, you're born of water and the Spirit. It's a powerful thing. It's very important to God. And the Jews refused that. They were going to be saved by doing the works of God according to law. No, they weren't. Because this is a new covenant. This is a new thing. And he said let's get back here. See where I was at. 14:2. I heard a voice from heaven, the voice of many harpers. As the voice of a great thunder, I done that. And they sung a new song, I done that. They're redeemed from there. 14:4, I lost where I was at. And those were they which are not defiled, when they're virgins. These are they that follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. They are redeemed from among men, the first fruits of God unto the Lamb. You read Romans 8:23 and James 1:18, and it tells you that the early church was the first fruits unto God. So who is this? This is the early church going forth, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Jews. All right? This is what you're seeing here. It's a picture of that. They're going forth doing all this preaching. And then he says in Revelation 14:5, and their mouth was found no guile. They're without fault before the throne of God. Now, are they perfect? No, they're covered by the blood. And they're filled with the Spirit. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having an everlasting gospel. Let you what? The everlasting gospel to preach to them that dwell on the earth and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people. Everybody goes to hear that gospel. Sing with a loud voice, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and sea and the fountains and waters. And they followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city which made all nations drink of the wine of her fornication. Now see, you got here the New Jerusalem being the symbolic picture of the church, as well as the 144,000. I do that in detail, and I prove that in detail in my teachings on the true Israel of God. And if any of you want to hear these teachings in detail, you can go up to Right Divine the Word. They're on there, every one of them, in video form. And they got scriptures popped right up on the screen. Oh, Brother Smith, that stuff's too long. Yes, right. You wouldn't want to spend 2 hours listening to what it took me 12 years to put together. Because 2 hours is too long. 12 years is a long time too. But God thought it was important enough that he stopped everything I was doing and showed me this stuff. Because he wanted us to understand how important the gospel of Jesus Christ is, even in the world we're living in today. Now we realize that the beast, the 24 elders, are symbols of the church. And so we have that same vision also in the book of Ezekiel. And I won't get any part of that. Let's put that up there. Just the thing up there. I'm going to quit here. I'm going to get to Ezekiel later if I do the second half of this. Would y'all like to hear the rest of it? Have you? I heard it pretty dead. Would y'all want to hear the rest of this? If you do, I'll finish it. I know somebody, who gives a rip about that stuff? All right, in book, people don't realize that the book of Ezekiel and the book of Revelation is the same books. They're identical. Look, they talk about the throne vision. That's in Revelation. The book is in Revelation and Ezekiel. The four plagues. Look how it kind of goes through there, similar too. The slaying of the altar, the wrath of God, the seal of the saints' foreheads. See, that's the sealing of the 144,000 that you find in the book of Revelation. What is that? What is the sealing of the 144,000? Get baptized in Jesus' name, getting the Holy Ghost. Hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ that the apostles preach. You want to see the sealing of the 144,000? Read the book of Acts, because that's where it took place. When the apostles went out and preached to the lost and got them sealed with the seal of God, that's exactly what it is right there. The coals of the altar, no more delay. The eating of the book, the measuring of the temple, flip over to the other side. Jerusalem and Sodom, cup of wrath, the vine of the land, the great harlot, which is Jerusalem fallen, the lament over the city, the scavenger's feast. What is scavenger's feast? It's when Jerusalem falls and the buzzards come to eat the dead folks. That's what a scavenger's feast is. How many knows you get a lot of bodies, you got a lot of dead horses? Because how many knows they rode horses in those days? You got a lot of dead things for the scavengers to eat. That's what the vulture is, a symbolic of death and destruction. The battle of Gog and Magog. And that's not in our future. Well, I thought it was going to be a great war and we were all going to have to die. I'm not even worried about that. We may be a war, but it ain't in the Bible if it is. The New Jerusalem. That is nothing but a picture of the church. The river of life. What is that? The Spirit of God that's in us. The river of life. Out of you is going to come rivers of what? Living water. This spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. Praise God. See, this imagery, people make it too complicated. But if you really study it, it gets really simple. Because it's how God sees his church. And the victory that he's put in his church. And all the power he's put in his church. I'm going to tell you, if everybody in church got really serious and got to really praying and really focusing on God, I'm going to tell you something. You can stir up a spiritual storm that I don't know if it'd ever be quenched. I'm just telling you, there's power in the blood. We sing that old song. There's power in the Spirit of God. And why are you telling us this, Brother Smith? Because I know you've been taught all your life that one of these days, all this stuff is going to hit you. A third of the world is going to die. You're going to see an Antichrist in your future. How many have heard of an Antichrist going to come and rule the world someday? Well, that Antichrist, I tell you, but I got Jesus Christ. I'm not looking for Antichrist. This stuff that they pushed off into the future, because there was a man that's already sitting in the temple in their day. And he took away the sacrifice in their day. In the midst of that 3.5 year time of siege, there was a man, Eliphaz Levi, that sat in the temple and took away the daily sacrifice. Already happened during this time that flows right with the other spirit of prophecy. But we got people living in fear. I don't want to live in fear of that. I just want to have my fear of God, which is my reverence of God. When the Bible talks about fear of the Lord, that means reverence the Lord. Have reverence to him because how powerful he is. These images I'm showing you, I'm not going to get into Ezekiel because I want to go to Ezekiel and show you the same exact vision as given by Ezekiel with different symbols but meaning the very same thing. And I want to, if what's so powerful, I want to show you that when these beasts actually flip their wings, the scriptures actually say that that's the voice of them preaching the gospel. That's powerful when you see that. So you see, it's just, these images are there. But it's powerful. What's it telling? Folks, I'm going to tell you, let me close it with this. We're it. If the church of today don't rise up and be what God has said we can be, there ain't nothing else going to rise up and be anything. God is counting on us to stand up and be the four beasts and the 24 elders. He's counting on us to stand up with seven eyes and seven horns inside of us and make a difference in our world. He's counting on us to stand up and get the gospel to a lost world out there. He's counting on us to do this. Praise God. And He sees us as powerful because He is in the midst. There's a lamb with seven eyes, seven horns in the midst of this church that's given them the power and the authority to do all this. Amen. I hope that helps somebody today. Because I'm going to tell you, you're not anemic church. You're a powerful church. If you will believe that and not be looking to all the fear of the future. I don't fear the future. I worry about what's going to happen to some because of what I worry about, even where our nation's headed. But I'm not going to let it take away my faith in God. Because greater is He that's in me than He that's in the world. And if He's got an everlasting kingdom, I'm going to be in it to the end. Let's stand. Amen. I got to get you out of here. I ran over 10 minutes, but they stole 10 minutes of my time. I just got it back. Amen. Praise God. I'll be like my old pastor. We went to Heaven Fellowship. How many of you former Pentecostals remember the old, what they call fellowship meetings? Anybody remember them where you go and three or four different preachers preach at midnight, you know? They told my old pastor one time, they gave him the service about 10 o'clock at night, said, we didn't mean to take so much of his time. He said, you didn't take none of my time. He said, I'm going to preach my whole time I got, whether we're here to midnight. But I won't be like that. Praise God. I was nice. I quit in the middle of the middle of the middle. Actually, that's a half of the teaching. I gave you a half of the half. So I just did a fourth. That's a 1/4 judgment. Amen. All right. Praise God. All right. You love Jesus today? Don't it ought to make you feel good. This is how Jesus sees you. Hallelujah. You didn't know you was an elder, did you? You're one of the 24 elders. Yeah. Amen. You know you're part of the 104,000. Yes, we're the church. We got awesome power because we got the Lamb in us. We're going to go forth in glory. Amen. Why don't we thank God for what He's given us today? Jesus, I love You today. Thank You for Your Spirit, Your blessings, God. We pray Your anointing and Your power. Help us to wake up, God, and see what You've invested in Your people. You first invested Your life, Your very life, that we could have eternal life. That we could, Lord, You rose and You poured Your Spirit out to empower us. Lord, You've given us revelation and understanding. You've opened our eyes that we can see. God, You've invested kingship and authority in us. God, help us, Lord, to understand what the Spirit is even saying to the church in this day and hour. And help us to go forth in unity and in love and preach the truth in love. That people could be saved and could come to You and can have tremendous understanding of the things of God and fall in love with You, Father. Keep us this day, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. You can go to McDonald's. Amen. Go ahead. Praise the Lord.